presenting the Packintell trackball model IBPC40. Yeah, this is definitely a weird one. First and foremost, because of this brand name, Packintell. It's like it's some kind of weird joint venture between Hewlett-Packard, Packard Bell, and Intel. And somehow out of that came this trackball. And especially this slogan here, the streamlined trackball rendering gravity trivial. I didn't know a trackball could do that. And then on the back here, if you look at this packaging, does that remind you of something? This is very similar to the graphic design that Logitech used on their products in the late 1980s up through about the mid-1990s. This green and red were the colors of their logo, and for some reason they love to put text around curves just like this. And I noticed all around this box it doesn't give any information about the manufacturer of this product, except for the Packintell name. So clearly this was some kind of knockoff brand back in the day. Well, let's see what they have to say here. Beyond the basics, discriminating consumers deserve more. Setting new standards unparalleled. Well, it's a serial trackball, so it is unparalleled. Precision and durability. Maximizing comfort, ergonomic design with you in mind. Main features. They go on about the optomechanical technology, compatible with Microsoft and mouse systems. Resolution from 40 to 1500 DPI. It originally came with a multilingual user's manual, driver, and test program on a 5.25-inch 360K disc. And as you would expect, it runs on any PC, XD, or AT. But I don't understand this. It says PC or MS-DOS 3.0 or later for serial port and 3.3 or later for mouse port. Unless they're talking about a bus mouse version of this. Dual floppy drive or one floppy drive and a hard disk. Unfortunately, no date or anything else on this, just a part number. And opening it up, we can see the entire trackball there and this display package here, IBPC40. Unfortunately, it is missing the manual and the disk, so we just get the trackball. And like I said, this is a serial port version. So unfortunately, I will not be able to use it with my Tandy 1000SX because that does not have a serial port built in. And I do have a mouse with this computer, but it's a bus mouse, not a serial mouse. But I do have another Tandy computer I could use this with, which you may be able to see in the corner of your screen. Well, I don't know if that's rendering gravity trivial, as the box claims, but certainly it does roll quite smoothly. And we get three buttons. I guess this would be left, but I don't know which one is right and which one is middle. Unless maybe if you're using it like this, I guess this would be left, that would be right, and this would be the middle click. I like how the logo is not even put on straight. Although it's not just a flat sticker, it actually has raised lettering. But you can see they didn't quite get it lined up with the cutout in the plastic where it was supposed to go. On the back of this nice white plastic, which is not yellowed at all, we get some rubber feet, a quality assurance sticker, and a switch for two different modes. I don't know which one is which though, because there's mouse systems and Microsoft, so MS could mean either one of those, and then PC. I assume MS means Microsoft because it came set to that position, and that was the more popular choice. Finally, we do have some manufacturer information. ICA Technology Incorporated, IBPC20, wait, it says IBPC40 on the box. And we have an FCC ID number, I'll try to look that up. See if I can get any more information on it. Made in Taiwan. Patent pending. Serial number in the 25,000 range. So, let's hook this up and see if it works. The computer I'm going to be using it with is this Tandy 1000 RLX. It was the successor to the 1000 RL, which I did a video about years ago, and a competitor to the IBM PS1, which I also did a video about. In a nutshell, this has an AMD 286 processor running at 10 MHz. It has VGA graphics, 1 MB of RAM, a high density 1.44 MB floppy drive. It can run Windows 3.1, but it's not an AT class computer. It's actually still only an XT class system. It has an 8-bit ISA expansion bus, an 8-bit IDE hard drive interface, an XT keyboard interface, no high IRQs, and no high DMAs. So it's really quite an oddball of design. It has the same slimline pizza box style case as the 1000RL, with a fanless 25-watt power supply, one 8-bit ISA expansion slot. You see it has VGA graphics instead of the Tandy CGA graphics. Parallel printer port, important for this video, is the 9-pin serial port. Joystick ports for the Tandy color computer style joysticks. The Tandy sound is still built in with three voices, a noise channel, and 8-bit digital audio. So you get an earphone and microphone jacks and a volume control. PS2 keyboard and mouse ports, although the PS2 mouse port does not work in Windows 3.1. So most of the time with this computer, you're going to end up using a serial mouse anyway. So it's a perfect opportunity to try out our serial trackball with it. I don't have the original Tandy VGM 225 monitor that was sold together with the 1000RLX when it was new. But that's actually a good thing for us, because that monitor had the most grainiest image I've ever seen on a VGA monitor, with a whopping 0.52 millimeter dot pitch. So instead I'll be using this Iezo FlexScan L771 19.6 inch 1600 by 1200 resolution LCD monitor, which cost over $5,000 when it was new. I did a video about this a couple years ago when I got it. So here we go with the Packintell trackball connected to the Tandy 1000RLX. So the cute mouse driver detected it as a Microsoft mouse, so the MS setting is the Microsoft mouse setting. So let's try it out just by loading edit. Well, I'm not getting any cursor movement. But if I hold down the left mouse button, you can see the cursor disappears. And the same thing if I press this button, which is the right mouse button, cursor goes away. So the buttons are working, but for some reason the trackball itself is not. But now, just as a test, I unloaded the mouse driver. I'm going to switch it into the mouse systems mode, which is labeled as PC for some reason. I'm going to reload the mouse driver. Now detected it as a mouse systems mouse. See if that works any better. Well, I still get no movement, but it is detecting the buttons. Same thing with this diagnostic program. No cursor movement, but it is detecting the left button, the right button, and the centre button, which is this one. So the buttons are working, but for some reason the trackball itself is not. So I'm going to open this thing up and see what's going on. I had a peek under the QA sticker and these 2 feet, and there are no screws under there. So I think it's just these 2 screws at the bottom here to take it apart. I also remembered back in 2013, I did a video about a PC accessories keyboard trackball combination, which was made by Chickeny. And in that case, it had the same problem. The trackball was not working, but the buttons were working. And that must have been a problem with the circuitry, because in that case, the rollers were spinning and the optical sensors in my camera, I could see that the IR emitters were functioning. So I'm not sure if that's going to be the case of this one as well. And I'm not sure I'm going to be able to take this apart that easily. I think there may be plastic clips or something around the edge. Is this? No, that's molded into the plastic. So it's, some trackballs have a collar around the trackball that unscrews, but this is molded into the plastic. So I'm not really sure how this comes apart. Oh, there's popping apart. Although I'm probably breaking the clips in the process. As well as damaging the plastic. Alright. Yeah, the rollers are definitely spinning, although they have like rubber pinch rollers on them that are a little bit dirty, but I don't think that would stop it from working entirely. As I spin the ball, it's definitely spinning those optical wheels. I don't know, I'll plug it back in and see what's going on, see if I can see those infrared LEDs on this one. Now I switched over to my Digital 8 Handycam, so you can see that when I turn off the lights and turn on night shot, you can see those infrared LEDs in the sensors. So clearly those are working. That's how an optical mechanical mouse or trackball works. It shines an infrared LED, the little wheel of the cutouts in it alternately blocks and lets through the light, and an infrared sensor picks it up and it recognizes that alternating between blocking and letting through the infrared light as motion. So those are working. And for you 555 timer fans, there's one made by National Semiconductor. The other chip on the board is also made by National Semiconductor. It's an ICA IM8918. I looked it up. I couldn't really find anything relevant about it. Also has a 1989 date code, it looks like. Next to it is probably one of those little 32 kilohertz crystals. That's funny. It looks like it was meant to have a transistor there, but they just ended up putting in a diode. Although there is one transistor there. Otherwise, it's just a bunch of resistors, capacitors, and diodes. So that's the Packintell Streamlined Trackball from 1989. Looks like in addition to rendering gravity trivial, they also rendered reliability trivial.